Welcome to Norfolk Perspectives. I'm Bob Batcher. And I hope you're doing well because the person on this sofa is going to make sure you are doing well, and hopefully I am too. Ruth Jones, the executive director for the YWCA for Southampton Roads. How are you doing?
I'm doing well, Bob. How are you?
Pretty good. You've been here for a year in Hampton Roads, but I've been wanting to meet with you for a long time because I used to drive down Jamestown Crescent, Collie Avenue, and I'd see this little building alongside the river and say, okay, it's W, so can I go in, and do they have a treadmill? So let's start there. Can I go in, and do you have a treadmill?
We're a little building, and we do a lot of things in that building, but we don't have treadmills. The YWCA Southampton Roads is an organization working to eliminate racism and empower women. And in that building specifically, we have a number of our programs, including our before and after school staff who go out into the community to provide child care in the schools. We have individuals who work in our sexual assault support services in that building, providing counseling and community outreach. And then we have all of our administrators in that building. But we do a lot in the community as well.
It is a small building. How do you pack them all in there?
With a lot of vision and tenacity and just will to get things done.
And you're 24/7?
We're 24/7 in terms of our hotline and a number of the services we provide. Our building closes at about 5, sometimes 7 o'clock, but we have a hotline. It's a 24-hour hotline, 226-YWCA, that individuals can call if they are impacted by domestic or sexual violence.
Okay, let's talk about that because it's a serious topic.
It is.
And it's not something that's always talked about.
It's not something that's always talked about. In fact, there aren't enough people in the community who know about the YWCA and the work that we're doing each day to impact the lives primarily of women and their families. I tell people when they refer to us as the Y, we're not the Y, we're the YW, and the W makes a difference. We provide emergency shelter for victims of domestic violence. We also provide permanent housing for that same population. We provide the counseling, as I mentioned earlier, legal advocacy, hospital accompaniment, affordable child care. Again, primarily for women, and that's very different from the YMCA. So I often say, and I think sometimes people are surprised, we're not the Y. We are the YW. The W makes a difference.
Well, and if it means anything, I learned about you being 24/7 and the impact that you have from a woman who was in her darkest period who made that phone call.
Mm-hmm.
And because of that phone call, from that, and I don't know if it went into that tiny little building or not, but she started a journey of recovery and some salvation too.
Right. Most women definitely come to us in times of crisis. We've served, fortunately and unfortunately, over 250,000 women in the first 100 years of existence in this community. Unfortunately, domestic violence and sexual violence are not things that have necessarily gone away. And so months like this, when we raise awareness about domestic violence in our community, are so important to our organization and the work that we do, because it engages individuals and gives them a way to become involved in the movement.
Well, month of October.
Month of October is Domestic Violence Awareness Month, and the third week in October is the Week Without Violence. That's a national YWCA signature program. It's a time for us to bring battered women together, as well as victims and advocates, to connect with the cause, to act on behalf of the cause, and for individuals who choose to donate in support of the cause.
You know, Ruth, let me ask you, because we tape these shows kind of stack them, and the day that we're taping, the government shut down, the federal government shut down. And our model has always been, well, we'll look toward a government program. But we're not really talking about a government program here. We're talking about connecting people together, right?
We're talking about connecting individuals, but we do depend heavily on the government. In 1994, our legislators passed a bill to make sure violence against women in our community could be addressed in a meaningful way. Through that piece of legislation, the government approved funding. The government also allocated tools for police officers to better respond to incidents of domestic violence. And the government also created harsher penalties for abusers. So we depend on the government for legislation, but we also depend on the government for funding. 47% of our funding for the YWCA comes from government dollars. So when we begin to talk about and think through how to respond to a government shutdown, it's very real for us in terms of the crisis and the moment of uncertainty.
So it really kind of can enhance that crisis for someone who's in that moment of uncertainty.
Yes.
Ruth, I want to have you back on to talk more about that journey that women can go through by hooking up with the YW. Thanks a lot for everything that you're doing right here in Norfolk.
Thank you.
Thank you. When we come back, we're going to be talking about another way of plugging in and having an impact. Stay tuned.
It's one of the many ways to fight osteoarthritis pain. For more information on managing pain, go to fightarthritispain.org.
Welcome back to Norfolk Perspective. Okay, I end every show with the phone number. What's the phone number, Halima?
664-6510.
That's right. And guess what? If you call 664-6510, there's a slight possibility that you're going to talk to Halima. And Halima Arias, who is running that whole shop, but more importantly, you're going to talk to some really cool people who want to talk to you, right?
Right, absolutely.
Did I just kind of blow the whole segment? Is that what this is really all about?
Not at all.
I mean, I've been giving that number out for years, and people have really been calling it, but let's put it in perspective. How many people call you a day?
On an average day, anywhere from 1,500 to 2,000 calls are received a day.
Hello.
That's just for phone calls.
And what do you do with those phone calls?
Well, depending on the nature of the call, some calls are just basic inquiries. Perhaps we want to know, where can I get a marriage license?
Time out. Not that I'm interested.
Right.
Where do you get a marriage license?
Actually, at the Norfolk Circuit Court.
Oh, cool. I didn't know that.
So they ask questions like that. Where can I get a divorce, unfortunately?
I don't care about that.
And then also complaints such as grass, exterior concerns with homes, things like that. So it just depends on the nature of the issue, how we process it, but basically everything.
I heard one time that a code complaint could be touched by 16 different units of the city.
Depending on the nature of the issue, it's possible, yes.
So to expect a resident to figure out which one of those 16 would be horrendous, wouldn't it?
It would.
But that's what you guys do every day.
That's what we're here for.
So how do you do that?
Well, basically, it's through a lot of education. It's a lot of training. The ladies who work in the call center are citizen service advisors, and they are trained to learn ordinances, to learn current topics, issues, basically a little bit of everything, so that if a citizen does call, they're not supposed to be equipped to know what ordinance or what code goes to what. That's what we're here for. We're here to help you. We're citizen service advisors.
Okay, now we were joking that maybe I should do this interview over the phone. So let's pretend I dial 664-6510.
Yes.
You answer.
Yes.
And I give you, I don't have any complaints. I want a compliment. My trash got picked up on time.
Sure.
And I live where I live, and I want to say thank you to the employee. So how are you going to, okay, and I hang up.
Yes.
So now what do you do?
What I'm going to do is I'm going to put your concern into our impact system. And that system, basically, after getting your information, is going to go directly to that department, letting that department and his director and supervisor know that we received a compliment from a citizen, and this is his contact information, so they can relay that information and recognition to the employee.
Okay, so you do follow up.
Yes.
Okay. I have a complaint that just came to my mind. A street light's out.
Yes. So.
But I don't have my phone, but I have my computer. Can I still...
Yes.
Get a hold of you?
You can. And that's actually through Citizen Request Tracker. That would be through online. And we would also follow up with you, even though it's online.
Okay. So I go online, norfolk.gov.
Yes.
And I look for Request Tracker?
Request Tracker, yes. On norfolk.gov on the left-hand side of the main page.
And that's the same as calling you?
Same as calling us, you're going to get the same level of customer service, the same level of experience, and you're still going to get a follow-up.
Okay. Now, I want to schedule bulk waste.
Yes.
How do I do that?
You can do that online via request tracker. You can do that via phone call, as long as it's before 3 p.m. on your trash day. And you can also do it via your iPhone.
Okay. Now, so I finally cleaned out my garage. My trash day is on Thursday, so I got to make sure I call you by 3 o'clock on Wednesday.
Yes.
Now, if I call, though, it's 2 o'clock, you guys are really busy, and I get a voicemail?
No, you're not going to get a voicemail during the day.
I'm not?
No, you're not going to get a voicemail during the day, only after hours.
Really?
No, only after hours.
Wait, I'm calling City Hall, right?
Yes, you're calling the city of Norfolk, but you're not going to get a voicemail during the day, only after hours.
Cool.
But you can submit your request through the iPhone or online, and those are still processed at the same time as we're taking incoming calls.
Okay. What's the craziest call you've gotten?
The craziest call we've received is a resident was unhappy with the type of ice cream truck music that was playing through the neighborhood. They preferred more jazz instead of the jingle that the ice cream truck does.
That would be kind of cool.
Yeah, so they wanted something a little bit more hoppier. And unfortunately, we weren't able to change his selection because it is his preference.
But what did you do with that call?
It's interesting that you asked that. We asked him, did you happen to speak with the driver perhaps when he stopped by? And we gave him a suggestion of perhaps the next time he came through the neighborhood, you might want to suggest that to him. Amazingly enough, he did change the sound it was a hoppier, more jazzy jingle, and he appreciated that we gave him that suggestion. So we really do take types of calls.
But wait a minute, what you just described, though, was what we've also talked about with the city called Neighbors Building Neighborhoods.
Right.
And that not necessarily are we the best place to go to solve your problem.
Exactly.
But one thing we can help is help redirect and get you engaged. And
right.
That's what you did with that call.
Yes, yes. It's not necessarily a complaint. He just felt that this might be a better opportunity, think people could hear jazz perhaps instead of the usual ice cream truck jingle. So we just gave him a suggestion and a push in the right direction.
That is, because I'm not sure if I would have handled it quite the same way.
Yes.
But so what about that person obviously you developed some friendships through this too then?
Yes, a lot. Many civic leaders. Sometimes we do get complaints where unfortunately we can't offer those exact type of suggestions. Mm-hmm. However, we can suggest perhaps you could speak with your local civic league leader and perhaps they could come up with an option for how you can solve this concern. So we definitely, along with Neighbors Building Neighborhoods, make sure that it's not all on the city. And unfortunately, sometimes the city does have to take over those concerns, but we do try to offer an option.
Kalima, I want to say thank you for being here and doing
you.
What you guys do and pass along to the staff the appreciation that not only does the city administration have for that staff, but I think for the resident too. We hear over and over again, what a great way to get plugged in. And now I understand why.
Yes.
That's why.
That's why.
Kalima, thanks a lot.
Thank you.
664-6510.
664-6510.
We want to hear from you.
Thank you.
We'll keep promoting it. Thanks a lot. When we come back, it's going to be music to your ears. Well, maybe not right there, but they'll talk about music. Stay tuned.
Those dealing with the daily struggles of caring for a loved one, we hear you. That's why AARP created a community with experts and other caregivers to help us better care for ourselves and the ones we love.
Welcome back to Norfolk Perspective. Okay, I promised music. So guys, you ready? Oh, no, we're not going to. Okay, we're going to talk music. I got Eric Bornstein with me, who is the Virginia Symphony Orchestra President and Executive Director. You are the guy in charge.
Hey, Bob.
How's it going?
I guess I am. Going terrific. The season launched in a spectacular way a couple of weekends ago with Midori, the world-famous violinist. you know, it is going extremely well for the Virginia Symphony.
So if you have one violinist, why do you need the whole symphony?
Yeah, she needs us to kind of make it happen. Yes.
Okay, now you've got some other things up your sleeve for down the rest of the season.
We do.
They happen to be sitting right next to you.
Absolutely. Our next two programs are ones we're very excited about. And Brent Havens is here with me. Brent is the arranger and conductor for our opening Pops concert.
Who happens to be all around the infamous...
Whitney Houston. We're doing Whitney Houston.
You scared me there for a moment.
No, I thought you were. Yeah, okay.
You thought I was going to go with the.
Yeah, I thought you were going to go somewhere else, and I went, oh, no, I better not go there. Yeah.
Whitney Houston.
Whitney Houston, yeah. Now, the music of Whitney Houston, obviously.
Oh, thank you. Because when I think of Whitney Houston, I don't think of symphony, although she had a lot of strings.
She had a lot of orchestration in a lot of it, and a lot of synthesizers, too, which we're not going to be. We are going to have a keyboard player and a drummer and a bass player and a singer, but we have the full Virginia Symphony as well. So
no,
it's gonna
synthesizers?
Be, well, there's going to be a synthesizer in the keyboard, but along with all the strings and the woodwinds and the brass and everything else. So
Brent is a Hampton Roads native, and he's right here, but his programs and his arrangements are world famous in our world. So he goes all over the world working with other symphonies, and he's our friend right here. And so we're going to open our season with one of his programs.
Awesome. Now, have you done the Whitney Houston thing before? Or?
We did. We premiered it once in St. Louis with the St. Louis Symphony in May. So this is our second time doing the show.
But the first time right here.
First time right here in Hampton Roads, yeah.
So we're Chrysler Hall?
Chrysler Hall and the Ferguson Center. We're doing a Friday and a Saturday night version of it. And it should be just a blowout party for the Virginia Symphony to open our pop season.
So you're going to be turning your back in about 2,500 seats. I shouldn't say that, though, right?
No. Oh, it's fine.
Should I not remind you of that?
It's who I am, yeah. That's how people know me. They don't know me by my face. They know me from my back. Yeah,
okay, and we had that discussion prior, too, because now, Benjamin Rouse, I just saw a press release that said new resident conductor.
I've been promoted to resident conductor.
But I saw you're in front of the group.
Backside is what you're saying.
Yeah,
yes.
A while back.
Or maybe you were thinking of another word for it. Yes, it is my fourth season with Virginia Symphony Orchestra, my first as resident conductor. I've been promoted.
So does this mean you have to live at Chrysler Hall?
No.
What makes you a resident conductor, then?
These are terms which are used in the industry, associate, assistant, resident conductor, and they're not exactly scientific ones, but it represents an increased degree of responsibility on the different seasons that the Virginia Symphony Orchestra performs.
Okay. Now, Brent's going to be doing the Pops with Whitney Houston. And you're going to be doing the serious stuff. Huh?
I do a fair amount of Pops myself as well, but the next thing that I've got coming up is Beethoven's Fifth, so I guess it doesn't get much more serious than that.
That
That's
is
in
right.
November.
Okay, yeah. So what are you going to do new with it, though?
Well,
what do you have up your sleeve?
That would be spoiling the surprise, wouldn't it? The thing is that...
That's assuming the host would remember what you were going to do. See?
Well, but you said I had such a memorable... Never mind.
Never mind.
This is music that every time you hear it, you discover something in it. And it's every time that I return to that score, I see stuff that I didn't see before. And with all the musicians, I think we're able to approach it with new ears and give listeners an experience almost as if it's being made up in front of their very ears.
But does the audience, Eric, does the audience come with an expectation that there's a comfort in hearing what they already know?
Well, I would say yes, definitely. I mean, it's a symphony that people are drawn to. It's sort of a popular, it's maybe the most popular symphony ever, but people definitely have the expectation of how they've heard it on their record or CD at home and how they last heard it live. And it will necessarily be different from those things, and I think that's what makes it interesting.
Right. Now, I remember last year I came to one of the Pops that was the Barry Manilow one.
Yeah.
And I got to say, I came with and I think this is what you're going to be up against with Whitney Houston. I came expecting to hear Barry Manilow, but thank goodness I didn't. He was, is that kind of what you're up against with Whitney Houston?
It's the music of. We pay tribute to composers, performers throughout the season. And there are lots of expectations with our audience. When you're performing in front of almost 4,000 people every weekend, people are going to come with their own expectations. So that's our challenge. But fortunately, the Virginia Symphony's been able to meet and even beat all those expectations in the programs that we deliver. So With Brent's help, we can deliver a fabulous opening for our pop season, the music of Whitney Houston. Ben has been extraordinary on the podium with the Virginia Symphony, not just Beethoven's Fifth, but outdoor programs and family concerts, and he's been just there for us in all sorts of ways. So we know that when we go out there and do what we do, people are going to be pleased with it, mm-hmm. and excited, entertained, thrilled, whatever their expectation is. But we know we'll be able to deliver.
Cool. So the next two coming up is going to be the music of Whitney Houston.
Yes.
October 18th and 19th. And then good old reliable Beethoven mm-hmm. in a 21st century way. Come on.
Well, I mean, you're out of necessity. This is 2013.
And that's going to be November 16th, 23rd, and 30th.
That's how it sounds in 2013.
Yeah. And go online.
Absolutely, virginiasymphony.org, all spelled out. We have a brand new ticketing system. You can choose your seats, choose your price point, and very easy to buy tickets now.
And you have some more season coming up?
Yes, we keep going. We have our holiday pops just around the corner, more classical programs, more pops programs, family concerts. We do it all.
Cool. I am so glad you guys are here. And could you take us out with a song? No. Okay. Well, thanks a lot. When we come back, we're going to have a surprise masquerade coming up just for you. Stay tuned.
Up to 40% of businesses never recover after experiencing a major disaster. Make a plan at ready.gov/business.
Welcome back to Norfolk Perspectives. Well, guess what? Ghent is having a party and is being put on by the Ghent Business Association. Who would have guessed? Jennifer McDonald, how you doing?
Good.
So you're going to put it in context here. We're having a party, but you're not just having it just for any old reason, right?
No, we're having a big old street party on Collie Avenue.
And it's going to be when?
It's going to be Friday, October the 25th from 6 to 10 p.m. We've partnered with the City of Norfolk. Their Meet, Greet, and Imagine series that they've been doing on Granby Street is coming to Ghent. They've partnered with the GBA, the Ghent Business Association, mm-hmm. to have Masquerading Ghent. So Meet, Greet, and Masquerading Ghent on Collie Avenue.
Okay, so while you're working your way through what kind of costume do I want to wear, best tryout the week before Halloween is to come out on Collie Avenue and test it out.
Exactly.
And if it doesn't work, go back to Collie Avenue and buy a new one.
There you go. Hence, but if it works, you could win $500.
Hello, you got my attention.
Yeah.
Okay, now we're also sitting behind all of these masks because you guys just don't do it on one day. Pam, you've got some masks coming out for a good cause, right?
That's right. Part of Masquerade in Ghent, or where you'll get to see all these wonderful masks and they'll be part of an auction, is our mask making. And that has already begun and will be concluded on October 17th, where we're going to have a wine and cheese party at Harper
Gallery. Of course.
Of course. A little wine, a little cheese, a little mask. And we're going to have them on display at the Harper Gallery on Collie Avenue. The wine and cheese is from 6:30 to 8:30, so that will be the first time the public can come and look at the masks, decide which one they might want to buy at the auction, and also vote, because there's a contest in our mask making as well. There's prize money, and there's the People's Choice Award, and that way the public can vote as well.
You know, Pam, you put it in perspective here, because in the past we've promoted the Masquerade, and Kelly, I want to talk to you about that in a second, but I always thought, you know, who's going to wear these? But really, they're not necessarily for wearing. You can use them as a piece of art.
It's a piece of artwork, yes, definitely. And they start with a template, which is a very simple template. And these are purchased for $10. And the mask maker can do whatever he or she wants with
them. No rules?
No rules. And you can see that some of them are the template itself that's decorated. You can see this person cut the mask in half or the template in half and then made this beautiful piece. And then I love this one. I actually own it. and that hangs on my wall among black and white photography, and it looks fabulous.
Oh, cool. Now, Kelly, you've been engaged with this for quite some time, and this is not a brand new idea.
No, it's not. This is our 18th year. It actually started, in 1995, the Phantom of the Opera came to the Chrysler mm-hmm. Hall, if you remember that.
That was a huge experience.
A huge experience. And they wanted to have a party to celebrate that. So that's how it started. And the Ghent Business Association took it over after that. And we've been doing it every year since.
Cool. Now, along with the event's going to be a parade.
We'll have the costume parade where people line up, adults and children and pets and babies. So there's a category
anybody
for everybody.
Anything you can dress up can come to
right,
the parade, right?
Right. So there'll be the parade. We'll have live music by the DeLoreans, adult beverages, food, kids' activities. We'll have it all.
And then, of course, once the street opens back up, you can just hang around and go to the restaurants.
Go to your favorite Ghent restaurant.
We encourage that.
Garden Gazebo, I'm going to mention that.
Thank you.
You've been a stalwart there for quite a few years now in Ghent. Yeah. Why are these kind of events important to you as a retailer?
Oh, well, what we really love doing, and as being a board member of the Ghent Business Association, is providing something for the community and something they can enjoy, and then giving back to the community. You know, the Ronald McDonald House is going to benefit from the proceeds on the mask auction, and that's something that we're very interested in doing. It's one of our nonprofits in Ghent.
Well, and it's kind of part of the brand of Ghent, is if you're going to go and have some fun and connect with people, you can eat dinner anywhere, but if you really want to get connected and kind of have some fun, that's the place to go, right?
It is.
Jennifer, you got a couple of other events coming up down the year, throughout the year, right?
We do. We have our annual tree lighting for the holiday.
You fell into that one real well. So you are going to do that again?
Yes, we are. Good. Yes, we are. And then that kicks off open house weekend for holidays in Ghent. It's not too early to start thinking
about it. It's really part of the whole calendar.
Yep.
I got to tell you, my shins have recovered from the 10K that you guys did, too.
Okay,
that was a smashing success.
It was a really great success.
And again, it was a great example of giving back to the community.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So the masks have been made. Let's rewind here.
Okay.
They can go to
Harbor Gallery the night of October 17th, enjoy wine and cheese, and look at all of the masks. And by the way, I did want to mention this, Bob. We have masks made by students and by adults. And we have a third category this year. We've challenged our Ghent businesses to each submit a mask.
Ooh, that'll be it could be fun. Okay, and you don't have to be in costume. Although, if you want to, you could on the 17th.
Oh, no, not at all. You don't have to be at all on the 17th. Just enjoy wine and cheese and decide which mask you're going to bid on at the auction.
And then the 25th.
25th, be in costume if you want. You don't have to.
Well, some might show up not thinking they're in costume. They could blend right in.
True.
Who knows?
And you can pre-register for the costume contest. You can go to getnorfolk.com to pre-register.
And Kelly, this one's going to be launched way above anything we've done in 18 years,
great.
Right?
Absolutely. It's going to be a fabulous night. We're going to have lighting, music, food, great talent to come out and get to know your neighbor.
And what's really cool is you don't have to register. You don't have to sign up. You just have to show up.
Yes.
Yeah.
On the 17th and vote. These aren't up. Although if you could
resell this one? They're not up, but I can't wait to see what will be.
I know.
We'll have some great ones.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for everything that you guys are doing and bringing us into Ghent for more than just eating, but for really connecting up and being part of the heart. We want to hear from you what you'd like to see on TV48, but more importantly, what's going on in your neighborhood. Give us a holler at 664-6510. And as usual, it's a wonderful time to be in Norfolk just because of you and you. Thanks a lot.